Hello, everyone. Welcome to CESC 2020. My name is Dr. Stephanie Hurder. I'm a founding economist at Prism Group. We're an economics and governance advisory specifically for blockchain projects. And today I'm going to be talking about how do we think about measuring the economic health of blockchain networks and blockchain-based projects. So at Prism Group, we've worked with dozens of permissionless and permissioned blockchain-based projects. And throughout our work, we get questions over and over again across platforms having to do with what we would call the economic health of the blockchain systems. These questions are things like, what are the levers driving my token price? Is it entirely speculation or does my token have fundamental value? Are my mining rewards fair and sufficiently distributed, right? Am I rewarding validators or miners in proportion to the resources that they're contributing? Is my platform user-friendly for consumers? And I don't mean from the UI point of view, which is obviously important, but from the economic value point of view. And so we've thought a lot about how do we think about measuring these and how do we think about measuring them in a way that's potentially comparable across different projects. And as I said, we view these as questions of economic health. So economics has many different definitions, but we really think about it as the study of choice. So when you're thinking about economics and especially microeconomics, what you're thinking about is how are people who in this case are using your blockchain platform interacting with the system and what decisions are they making? And are these decisions in line with what you want them to do? These decisions can be, you know, as simple as does a customer of your project return and use it again? Or are miners and validators colluding or anything like this? These are all choices that they're making. And we think about economics as studying the reason why we make these choices. And when we think about what leads to economic outcomes, there are really two different sets of behaviors and parameters that we focus on. So the first is a user's individual preferences, right? So I am a person and I have a stockpile of GPUs. I'm trying to figure out how to make a return on them. Maybe I have specific constraints regarding my access to capital, regarding my access to low-cost electricity, and my goal is to make some money from mining. And this is going to interact with the economic design of the particular platform. What do your block rewards look like? What are incentive mechanisms? What are market mechanisms that you've introduced? And together, these create economic outcomes. And so it's important when you think about, you know, most projects, either explicitly or implicitly, have some set of economic outcomes that they want, right? It could be that they want 100 validators. It could be that they want 50 dApps. It could be that they want their consumers to interact or their users to interact with them every month for a year, whatever it is. These are really a combination of the preferences and constraints of the people who are coming to use your platform and the economic design that you've chosen. And many of you who have seen our talks will be well familiar with this framework. This is the house, and these are the levers of economic design. And I'm not going to dig too deeply into this, but at a high level, there are many more levers that impact economic outcomes on your particular project than you would think. So a great example for this, for example, a lot of people in blockchain are thinking about the DeFi space, and DeFi projects tend to use a lot of auctions, right? They need a pricing mechanism. They want it to be relatively adaptive so that they use an auction design. And it turns out that there are books upon books upon books of how you can design auctions and how the change in the design can impact the change in the behavior of the people who are participating in the auction. A really great example that I like is that it turns out if you're familiar with eBay, you know that eBay auctions end after a finite period of time. It used to be that Amazon would have similar auctions for decentralized sale of goods, but those auctions would continue until somebody stopped bidding, right? There was no preset end time. And it turns out that this has a huge impact on how users and customers interact with the platform. And that's just one sub-bullet. So the takeaway here is there's a ton of different design decisions that impact the system and the economic environment you provide, and therefore what people who interact with your project will choose to do. And so when we think about evaluating the economic health of a blockchain project, and this can be a protocol too, this doesn't have to be a consumer-facing dApp, this can be something quite technical. You know, we start with, you know, is your project achieving the outcomes that you want, right? Let's sit down with the team and articulate, what is it that you want your project to do? What do you want people to do? What do you want users to, how do you want users to interact with each other? We get a lot of questions about benchmarking, and this is one of the reasons that we've started to think more about how do we think about key metrics, which is what I'm going to be talking about for the rest of the talk. How do the outcomes, you know, we get asked all the time, how do the outcomes on my platform, the decentralization, the token rate of return, the staking rewards, compare to other platforms? And then finally, how do we think about changing the design to improve maybe those metrics that we don't really love that much, that aren't really up to what we wanted? And so one of the fundamental challenges in answering some of these questions is that many of them require a common metric or a common way of measuring to be able to compare across platforms, right? If you're thinking about decentralization, which I'll talk about in a little bit, or staking rate of return, or fairness for validator rewards, it's not enough to just say, well, here's what I think this is, and therefore by my personal standard, you know, my platform is doing great. It's incredibly helpful to have a commonly understood set of measures that help you gauge both over time and across different projects, whether you're achieving what you set out to do. And this is something that's very, very common for national economies, right? So here I have a screenshot from one of the data products for the International Monetary Fund, the IMF. They produce a report every 6 months, which puts together, assembles, and publishes a set of basic economic health metrics. And you can see them here. They're things you've heard of. They're things like gross domestic product, inflation, unemployment rate, and they're able to collect them for the vast majority of nations in the world. And each of these metrics has its own problems. None of them is perfect. Obviously, there's been a lot of discussion about the pitfalls with GDP. The unemployment rate has problems. But just the act of putting understandings of how are these different metrics defined and how are they put together and how do they compare is a great way to start a conversation about the relative health of different countries and different countries' economies. And one of the things you'll notice about these different metrics that are used for countries is that all of them include some kind of behavior or choice decision made by people, right? So they have to do with, you know, it's a combination. For example, let's take the unemployment rate. Obviously, there's the state of the labor market, but the unemployment rate is a function of the hiring and employment decisions that businesses are making, as well as the decisions made by people in the labor market. So it's a combination of the surrounding sort of economic fundamentals, as well as decisions made by participants in the system. And that's what gives it such force. It really is an economic outcome that combines both of those levers that I talked about, the economic fundamentals as well as the decisions that people are making. And while there's been a lot of progress on metrics in the blockchain space, these types of outcome-based measures aren't really popular yet, right? So there are a lot of different projects that are working on dashboards and metrics. Here I've taken a screenshot from the CoinDesk Crypto Economics Suite, but this is by no means, you know, comprehensive. But here, for example, if you look at some of their network metrics that they're using, there are transaction counts, that's very helpful. There's transaction fees. But for example, if you wanted to say, you know, is my consensus process working well? Is my consensus process decentralized? Are my block rewards doing what they're supposed to? This doesn't really answer any of those questions that we hear over and over again, right? So we're thinking about how do we, what are the economic outcomes that we need to measure that really take into account people's decision-making and also answer the questions that we hear from platforms over and over and over again. So let me talk through an example to add some concreteness. So perhaps if you wanted to list, so the fundamental goals of blockchain as a as an industry or a set of projects, you know, saying that they want to achieve decentralization, if it's not the first, it's among the top goals that almost every project, you know, lists. And when we talk to projects about, you know, when you say you want to be decentralized, what exactly do you mean? We get a huge number of answers. So we had one client who was building a protocol and said they wanted to have a highly decentralized consensus process. And we said, what does that mean to you? And they said, well, we need at least 100 validators. Another one that I actually like is a project team said that, you know, we're decentralized if we, the founders, could disappear and the platform would still run. Another definition we hear is no one entity controls the system, right? And these are great answers. And I think particularly the second one is a great framework. But if you wanted to actually sit down and say, okay, let's measure how decentralized, let's say, the consensus process is for different protocols and see how they measure up, none of these answers is really getting you anywhere in terms of being able to quantify and compare. And this is a problem that we worked with the Open Application Network, the OAN, with. So the OAN has a token called Aon. They launched as a proof of work network and originally, you know, just had a standard proof of work consensus mechanism. And what they found a few months after launch was that their consensus process was very, very centralized. So they basically had three mining pools that were providing all of the block production. And this was not what they wanted. So they went through the process of developing something called the Unity Consensus Mechanism, which alternated between proof of work and proof of stake. The, one of the main goals of introducing this new consensus mechanism was to expand the number of different participants who were able to produce blocks and gain block rewards. So we worked with them on the design of this. And one of the questions that they had for us back in the fall and when we worked with them again in the spring was, okay, we feel like we've decentralized our protocol, but how do we know that block production is now more decentralized? Is there a way that we can actually measure whether the consensus process, and specifically block production, which is what we care about when we think about distributing power and influence, is actually more decentralized than it was before? And there are a number of different ways that we measure this, but one of the measurements that we focused on was called the HHI. And this is a standard measure when you study the economics of an economy and you're trying to understand to what extent is a particular industry run by a monopolist. And so we've taken the HHI and adapted it to make it a little bit easier to use. But the basic idea here is that when you have an HHI of one, it means that your entire industry is run by a monopolist. In the terms of consensus and block production, this would mean that a single address or a single miner was producing all of your blocks. Like, you only have one. As you move towards zero, you become more highly decentralized. And so you, you know, the goal, if you're saying you really want to be highly decentralized, is getting your HHI as close to zero as you can. And this is a metric that you can compute using on-chain data, right? You take the past X number of blocks and you compute the particular formula, and you can tell from, you know, the history of block production on chain exactly what this metric is. So it's something that's both comes from economics, has a long history and a long intuition, but also is relatively easy to compute. And so in working with the OAN, and one of the motivations for this project was that together with the OAN and Flipside Crypto, which is a leading blockchain data company, we developed a dashboard for the OAN to think about measuring some of these questions. And I'm gonna go back and forth between the dashboard and my slides. So you can see here, here's the dashboard, we'll be coming back and forth. But what we have here is actually this metric. So we worked with the team and we computed this particular metric of centralization for their block production. And here we have the HHI. And again, The closer you get to zero, the more decentralized your block production is. So if you're very close to zero, it means that a wide variety of different participants are getting to produce blocks that are added to the main chain. If you're getting close to one, it means you have relatively fewer mining pools or staking pools or validator pools, whatever you want to, whatever your particular protocol is using. And so what we found when we worked with the Aeon was that we were able to quantify just how much their decentralization had improved by changing consensus mechanism. So this purple line here is their measure of centralization or decentralization for proof of work only. So this is the consensus protocol that they had before. And once they added in proof of stake to their proof of work, they were able to decrease their decentralization or improve their decentralization down to this green line. So they dropped from 0.3 to 0.4 down to closer to 0.1. So this looks like a substantial improvement. And so the other question that they had for us was, how does this compare to Ethereum and Bitcoin? And because we have a standard well-defined measure of how decentralized is block production in mining, we can compare it to, this is the actual number for Ethereum, it's about 0.17, and this is the actual number for Bitcoin, which is about 0.09. And so you can see that the change in consensus mechanism took us from relatively centralized block production down to something that's more competitive with Ethereum. And just having is well-defined, economically motivated measure that could be computed and compared gives us a lot of information, right? I mean, this gives us a benchmark of what does Ethereum look like. One of the things that we noticed having gone through this was that even the numbers for Ethereum and Bitcoin are still not super decentralized. So this is Bitcoin's number is approximately equivalent to having 10 block producers. Like if you had 10 block producers in a row and each produced a block in order, you'd get about the same number there. And Ethereum is closer to having 5 or 6. So even though this is far more decentralized than the Aeon and they've improved, it's still not 100 miners, right? 100 miners would be very, very close to zero. So another thing this having this standard metric highlighted for us was that there's still a ways to go in decentralization just in general across major projects. So going back to slides, I think this is a great example. And you know, having worked with a particular project to think about what exactly do they want to answer and why is it important to them was very helpful. Again, as I mentioned, one of the things we've been working on at Prism Group is moving towards this shared standard set of economic metrics, right? How can we put together a set of metrics that apply across projects that let us address those key questions that we have in the front, that I talked about in the front of the presentation? So we are working with Flipside Crypto. Again, a leading data analytics platform. They specialize in chain walking, which is the collection and standardization and analysis of on-chain and sometimes off-chain data. And we've built a tool called the Crypto Economic Analytics Suite that answers some of these questions. And when we think about economic health, specifically in a blockchain network, one of the key things we're trying to get away from, which you see in a lot of metrics that are commonly used, is that the metrics that are used in the industry tend to focus only on the token, right? You hear about token market cap, you hear about circulating supply, you'll hear about change in prices, but you don't hear a lot about sort of how do you think about measuring things like decentralization of block production, which are fundamental to security, but not necessarily token related. So when we're thinking about how do we measure economic health, we think about the value of whatever the platform is to different groups of stakeholders. So obviously there's token holders. Token holders get lots of attention. But there's also validators, right? Are validators being rewarded fairly for their contributions? Does any particular validator have excessive market power? Are the incentives that are being provided strong enough to keep and attract validators who had security to your particular project? And then for users, if I'm a user using a token with a means of payment token, you know, how convenient is it for me to send money? How much am I paying in fees compared to the amount I'm sending? Is the pricing mechanism for the fees working? All of these different things are, you know, are fees excessively volatile? These are all economic outcomes that materially impact whether people actually find value in using a particular blockchain project. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about some of the other standard metrics that we are working on, that we've thought through and we think are very helpful in applying to particular projects over time, and then also comparing across different protocols. So for the token economics, what we, you know, what everybody wants to know is what is driving token prices, right? And if you see movement in token price, is it entirely driven by speculation? Is there fundamental value driving this? Is this changing over time? So getting at an economically motivated token price decomposition is really, really helpful to a lot of projects. In particular, and this was something that we was emphasized a lot when we were working with the AM team, is if you're thinking about if you're a founding team thinking about developing and moving forward a particular project, it is really difficult to manage a token whose entire value is speculation, right? If you're trying to think about what is the size of the block reward and tokens that I'm going to give to attract validators or miners, having a token whose price is jumping all over the place because it's entirely speculation driven makes your life a lot harder, right? It's also harder to manage the expectations of investors if your entire token is speculation driven in its price. So this is something that has a lot of secondary impacts on different stakeholder groups. So when thinking about measuring economic health of a token, one of the things we did before jumping into what's driving the token price was we wanted to set up a system or a set of metrics that would allow you to compare a token to a regular currency. Right, so for any major currency, the euro, the dollar, the central bank, in this case, it's the St. Louis Fed for the dollar, but this occurs everywhere, maintains databases of different metrics, right? So of the total currency in the economy, how much of it is at different levels of liquidity? That's M1, M2, those are different levels of liquidity of currencies. What's the currency velocity, right? Right now in the US, we are suffering from a severe economic recession due primarily to a reduction in velocity of the dollar. And then digging into what is basically the equivalent of GDP for a particular token, how much actual economic activity as opposed to speculative trading is occurring, and how do we measure sort of the total value in terms of goods and services sold that a project is currently taking place. And this allows you to really start to think about these tokens as a currency, right? Which in many cases, that's what the token wants to be. The founding team wants the token to be a currency. So let's start to look at its numbers like we would do with any major currency. And then once we have these different pieces, the exact decomposition of a token's fundamental value is going to depend on what the token is used for. Every token is a little bit different. But for example, you have a token that's a means of payment. So the fundamental value of the token in terms of its economics are going to depend on how often it's used to pay for goods and services. You could have staking returns, which add to the fundamental economic value of a token. There's a whole bunch of different uses that any token can have. So the exact formula and algorithms that are used to figure out speculative versus non-speculative activity are a little bit different. However, for Aeon, we have a combination means of payment and staking token. And just digging in here, let me briefly switch over back to the dashboard. When we took a look at what was driving the fundamental value of the Aeon token, we actually found that they had done a really great job building up their economic fundamentals. So this navy blue line is their 90-day trailing token price. And we found that probably 70% of their token price could be attributed to users wanting to use the token to interact with dApps, to buy goods and services, as opposed to speculating through an exchange. And there was also a modest contribution of staking. So they offer staking rewards on the order of a couple $1 million a year. And that was providing not a huge, but almost a cent bump to their token price. And this green line here was the speculative remainder. So what we found as we worked with the AN team was that they had actually done a really good job. And they're a team that's very focused on developing their dApp ecosystem. So perhaps it wasn't surprising that this was, you know, their token is relatively fundamentals driven in its price. But as I mentioned, this gives them, this lets them know, first of all, that their strategy is working. And it gives them more levers to think about how do they control the token price, as opposed to finding out that your token price is 90% speculation and there's really nothing you can do aside from, you know, social media activity to manage the price in a way that's useful for you. And finally, just briefly, as I mentioned, you know, we talked a bit before about decentralization in block production, but there's a lot of questions regarding validator and miner influence that don't tend to get captured in standard industry metrics, but are really useful to have and to compare across different platforms. So the types of qualitative questions that we've turned into numbers are things like, does a single block producer have disproportionate influence? Are the mining rewards sufficient? Is the allocation of rewards across miners fair? And in that, are miners who contribute more resources, such as hash power or staking in a proof of stake network, getting proportionally more rewards as part of the consensus process? And so these are some we've thought through, and these are some of the metrics that we've developed. If we had more time, I'd walk through how they're put together and the example we put together in AN. But these are numbers that can be computed using on-chain data that give a better idea that really can be compared across different projects. And let me see, I think I have time for one more. This is one of my favorites. When we were working with the AN team back in November of 2019, one of the questions that we got from their team all the time was, are staking rewards big enough, right? Are we providing a competitive return? And in this case, it's not just compared to other projects, it's a compared to other investment opportunities, right? If you're thinking about a staker who's deciding whether to stake tokens or to cash out and go get return from something else, you want to understand, are you giving sufficient return to attract the capital that you want? So we built a set of metrics measuring real and nominal incentive power. So this is the rate of return that a staker gets, in this particular case in the OON, for staking their tokens. And we have it in USD, and we have it in AON currency. And what you can see is that this has changed over time, but the equilibrium staking return for a staker in this system is right around 5% in real terms. And what's so interesting about that is this is basically exactly what you would want. So if you think about the, you know, benchmark rate of return to capital, it's typically between 5 and 10%. And what's unusual about blockchain platforms, and this one in particular, is that the rate of return to staking is determined in part by how many people are staking, right? So if you're offering 20%, you're going to get more tokens staked. The rate of return is going to go down because the total amount of rewards is fixed. So what you can see here is that in equilibrium, the staking return has really balanced out to about 5%, which is exactly what you would expect. And so one can imagine that it's not going to go much below this because 5% is sort of the minimum return you need to offer. And if the team were to increase the amount of rewards given in staking, you would expect to see an increase in participation. This would go up sort of temporarily. And then come back down as more people choose to stake their capital to get some of the additional rewards. And again, this is something that, you know, this is a metric that not only can be computed for a blockchain platform, but can be computed for any asset. And so it starts to add quantification to this very fuzzy question of, am I giving enough rewards? And what is the return to being a staker on my platform? And I think I won't have time to go through these, but just the last set that we thought about or what it was about ease of use. And if I'm a consumer who wants to use a token, particularly as a currency, how does it compare to PayPal, right? If I'm constantly having to worry about changes in fee transaction fees, where I can go to PayPal and know exactly how much I'm going to pay, that's not very attractive. So how do we think about making sure that this is the platform is cost effective, that there's not excessive volatility, and putting numbers on these so we can quantify them compared not only to blockchain projects, but to alternative currency transfer systems like Venmo, like PayPal, which eventually many blockchain projects want to be able to compete with. So these are some of those. Let me go through this. Yep. And to end, I just want to, end on a particular note. I think, as I mentioned before, when we thought about decentralization, one of the things that was most interesting to us as a team was not only thinking about the particular project we were working with, but thinking about the state of the industry. And I mentioned this before, but it was really surprising to us that for all of the discussion of decentralization and heralding Ethereum and Bitcoin, which are obviously pioneering platforms, that there's still a ways to go in terms of achieving decentralization for the industry as a whole. Most of the projects that we've worked with, that we see, are much more centralized than the aspirations of their teams and the industries would want them to be. And going through the process of computing these metrics, of thinking critically about them, really hammered that home for us. And so I think, not only are projects like this very useful to individual founding teams, but they help set expectations for the industry as a whole and point to where there needs to be additional work. So anyway, as I mentioned, I'm Stephanie Hurder. I am a founding economist at Prism Group. We do economics and governance advisory for blockchain projects. If you would like any additional information about the dashboard product that I showed you, which is now on offer, or anything about anything I talked about, please don't hesitate to reach out. All right, thank you.